Hi.
Hi,
Hi.
we're
Hi.
back. We
It's been a while.
were away, and 3 weeks went past. Whooshed.
What are 3 weeks to fucking pick to not be here?
Yeah,
lot of news.
it wasn't. It's because it's September and people came back from whatever, whatever third country with little tiny little fenced in luxury area they were taking a vacation at, and now they like shit started happening.
So yeah, this is the only show that also takes family holidays in third world countries, in fenced in areas.
No, we take offense at that. Offense, get it? Because it's fenced in. Ah,
Oh,
we.
it's good. Oh,
It's only started like what first
fence
minute of
off.
the show, and it's already happening. So, Kickstarter is our first port of whatever the a nautical pun that I didn't make. Port of call. There you go. There
There you go, you did
we
it. You wanted to resist it and you
yeah.
just sort of fell down the
We're
sinkhole of the joke.
traveling jokes
Traveling
is
jokes. These jokes are going away.
that's also a band name. Anyway, court case happened. So this is 3 weeks, just to say again. So there's a lot of stuff is pretty old in here. So
Yeah.
some of the stuff we'll introduce like, oh, remember when? And then like exactly. So, oh, remember when there was a court case about a Kickstarter in Washington State of USA, where the judge declared that you have to deliver your promises in a Kickstarter.
Oh.
Yeah, so
Yeah,
that's
it's
that
good.
was apparently the first time a similar thing has
I
happened.
believe it is a precedent. They're
Yeah.
like, this is the first one where people actually
Yep.
got something. They actually got nailed. Not a huge budget. It was 15 grand they asked for and 25 they got. Something about, one detail about this that confused me. Maybe I've got it wrong. But later on in the judgment, it says they've got to pay civil penalties and the state's court costs. Makes sense. The civil penalties amount came to $31,000, and it said $1,000 per backer. So does that mean that there were only 31 backers and they managed to get 25 grand?
So you see, I got confused about it as well. But let's quickly tell the backstory. So there was a campaign to give the deck of like it's about a, it's actually a deck of cards. It's not a video game. It's a playing cards thing with ho classic or vintage horror thing by the from the twisted mind of this Serbian guy. That's essentially what it said on the Kickstarter.
They're like, we got an artist from Serbia. They're like,
Yeah,
whoa, that must be
whoa. And people
horrible.
were like, oh, remember that movie, the Serbian film or whatever it's called? The one about
Remember the
rape.
power of rigor mortis?
Yeah, that's the one. So, they promised to if you paid $9, you would get a deck of cards which was decorated by this guy, printed on some rare paper or something. I don't know, like paper made of
Yeah, it would have
kittens
been
or
made nice.
yeah. And
Yeah.
they didn't do it. And so the people and this was like 2012. And in 2014, I think they finally filed a case against them, and then in now they won. But interestingly, the 31 people are. It's kind of weird because there was like 512, I think, people who backed at $9, but it
Huh.
seems like not all of them participate in the case, so not everyone's getting the
Oh.
compensation.
Huh.
That's the conclusion I made out of this, which is weird. But yeah.
Oh, I see. It's only been awarded to the 31 backers who live in Washington State. That's what it
Oh,
says here, just above.
right.
So it would have, but they don't actually have jurisdiction anywhere else.
So yeah, and these guys themselves aren't from Washington State though, which again I'm not sure how legally this pen.
I don't know. I guess just the fact that like one of the people, the person who was mad enough online
Yeah.
to sue was from there, maybe.
And the person seems to be himself or the company's registered in Tennessee, so whatever. I guess it kind of worked out in the end. But yeah, it's a precedent. Whether or not like it makes any difference in Europe, I'm not entirely sure. But they do sometimes refer to each other across the ocean, I think.
Maybe not directly, but I mean the fact that someone managed to do this in a court, in a Western country, means that people who are doing Kickstarters will have to consider this.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So cool, that happened. Next Kickstarter, we have several Kickstarter stuff today, is about the big old next big fuck off project, which is the BattleTech Kickstarter. Those of you who are old enough to remember will probably rejoice. There used to be, I think that was actually called just BattleTech or MechWarrior BattleTech, the 1980s game. And this is essentially the remake of one of those first MechWarrior games and as a turn-based strategy. The interesting bit about this one is that they, the first $250,000 they put in themselves, as I understand.
I believe they self-funded up to the first thing. So it, whatever happened, they would make something and would not be failing. It would just be them finding out how much more they'd add onto the game by the end of the campaign.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So they now have about more than like 1.2 million, I think.
They're on 1.23 million.
Yeah, exactly. So, which means they, the stretch goals, blah, 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 they unlocked some stuff. The only part I really care about is probably the PvP multiplayer thing, which is
right at the bottom of 2.5.
Yeah, exactly. It could still happen.
No, like, this isn't a mistake. They always put that shit that you know that you fucking want last one.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. Do they want it, though? I mean, do people...
They might not, but they know that you do.
I know, I'm not even gonna participate in this Kickstarter. The reason I'm not gonna participate in the Kickstarter is that they don't even bother to have a tiny engine demo thing at all. They just have concept pictures. And, you know, it's like, out of principle, I don't really support Kickstarters with concept pictures. Kind of strange.
But I mean, hopefully they make it to there and it's good, because then turn-based strategy multiplayer, that's something you could actually play.
Yeah, absolutely. But it also it meant to deliver 2017, so you take into consideration the whole thing where, you know, you add like an inch to your dick and then it will actually deliver in 2018 and like I may be dead by then, so I don't know. Yeah, if it's discovered I have cancer and it's discovered now, like, that is kind of the incubation period, probably, so I'd probably be dead by around that time that this is released. I'd be like, I never got to play the multi.
I think you should put that in the Kickstarter comments. It's like, I would give money to this because it looks cool, but, I mean, think about this. I could be diagnosed with cancer tomorrow. Might not actually get to play the PvP multiplayer.
Yeah.
Tell me it's worth it. Come on, convince me. And you're like, what?
Yeah, don't you have to, like, to put in a dollar and then that's... Then you can comment as a backer, and then you'll be like, "Well, I'm thinking about canceling my dollar."
You know what you do? You instead of putting like $200 into this and get something really cool, you put a dollar into 200 Kickstarters and sue the ones that didn't deliver.
Hedge your bets.
Hedge your litigation bets.
Excellent. Another news we have about Kickstarter is about Kickstarter. It's like it's a kickception.
Meta Kickstarter news.
Startception. So Kickstarter is no longer whatever it was before, and now it's a public. Was it public benefit?
Public benefit corporation.
Corporation. Yeah, which means that, as I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, that they essentially promise to be good guys. Isn't that what it means?
Yeah, I think, now that sounds like washy, but I think if you compare it to what like a regular corporation is essentially, in legal terms, a promise to make the maximum return for shares. So it's just two kind of ways of doing things in an official capacity, I believe.
Yeah. Okay. So they also need to, I think they're also promising to give 5% of whatever they make to... good causes, like that's also part of the deal, isn't it?
Yeah,
like
they have creative type, education-y, touchy-feely things. It's a really big list of touchy-feely, they sound great things, which makes me instantly like cautious and cynical, but I mean, in theory, it's great.
Yeah, exactly. All right, cool. Moving on to the last, and I was thinking actually putting this in the what the fuck section, like the end of the show. It started with, like, I think it was someone tweeted this, and I was like, oh, lol, that's funny, that's a Kickstarter about a hat. and I put it in the list. Then I came back to this, and I was like, oh, God, Andrew, what are you doing? Like, you can't put every fucking hat in the show. Like, you can't, there are too many hats, you can't do this. But I was like, okay, last chance Kickstarter thing, and I started reading through the thing. So essentially what it is, it's a hat with a little smartphone inside, really. And it has a screen, and there's like a very minute description of like tiny details about the screen, its size and pixel density and whatever. Doesn't mention where the batteries are, to be honest, which is alarming. So you may have to carry it as a backpack. But so I, when I heard, okay, hat screen, I'm thinking, and it has a cap, right? So I was thinking like it's probably on the inside of the cap, so
Yeah.
you run around, do your sports, and look up at the screen, go like, oh, it's 17 degrees Celsius. But no, the screen is on the top of the hat where you can't see it.
It's just here, down
Yeah,
on the
like
front.
you
You
can
had to
see.
ask a friend what the screen says,
Yeah.
but you don't
Oh.
have any friends because instead you've got an ingenious hat.
Yeah, exactly. If you ever had anyone, they probably just like discontinued the relationship immediately as this thing got shipped to your house. But yeah, it's baffling. Like I don't understand the logic behind. You can see all like tiny square in front of the hat. That's it. That's the screen.
The image, I do think this is a joke.
Could be, but like the thing that describes the screen, if you scroll down on the page, is extremely detailed. So maybe elaborate joke. Could be.
Maybe, because
Yeah.
like, it just looks like a patent image, really. Like, you can look that up and do that. Oh, maybe the details below are a little bit like over the top. But the thing is, like, the thing that makes me think it's not real is this image in like almost papyrus font saying "ingenious hat." Just this image floating in nothing, and then like the word "golf" just by itself. The word "children" just by itself. The word "people suffering," the phrase "people suffering from diabetes," just floating in nowhere. I'm like, why does this hat
But what
have
if
any
it's,
relevance?
but what if it's like it's by a turbo nerd, so they don't really understand fonts.
How about not understanding English? This one says "people suffering from heart."
I suffer from heart, Ed.
Yeah,
Shame on you.
bastard, you knew and you said
Yeah.
it anyway.
I've been born with heart, and I suffer from it since day one. Which leads us to the second section of our show, the shit we've heard about XCOM 2. Yep. So novel. There's a remember that novel that I couldn't finish. I did a series and I was reading that, and we still have like crazy plans about that. We didn't have time to do it. Remember that we did two carafes of wine. So anyway, XCOM 2 is gonna have again. They return to the form. They're gonna do a legit official novel for XCOM 2, and this is gonna come out when the game was supposed to come out in November. Unless obviously it gets delayed because the graphics of the novel weren't so good.
Yeah, they
And
want it just to be the best novel that it can be.
yeah, exactly. So this is about this. This links your defeat in XCOM 1 with your attempt to not be defeated in XCOM 2. And that's the novel, by some guy called Greg.
Greg Keyes.
Yeah, that's
Do you know
all.
Greg Keyes?
No, I don't know. That's all I know. There's nothing on. There's no other information there. At least on the XCOM whatever page.
Here we go. Gregory Keyes, born April 11, 1963, American writer of science fiction and fantasy, has written both original and media-related novels under both the names J. Gregory Keyes and Greg Keyes. Where's his bibliography? Started publishing in 96, so he's been around for a bit. It looks like Babylon 5 books, Star Wars books. Looks like nerd shit. I mean, at least it's the right kind of person.
I wonder if like you can tell which books are better and worse depending on if he signs off as Greg or Gregory.
Oh, I like that.
Like he has like, I'm not happy with this. I'm Greg on this one.
That's just Greg.
That's just Greg.
Yeah, here's my Infernal City 2009 Elder Scrolls. That's G. Gregory Keyes to you.
And like his friend or like his mom's like, so Gregory, how's the latest thing going? How's the book going? And it's like it's still Greg so far,
It's still Greg
but
so far.
I'm
I'm
trying to,
hoping with the advance I can buy an ingenious hat.
yeah, with the screen on the wrong side. So in other XCOM news, there's also obviously and inevitably Twitch plays XCOM.
Yeah.
I'm not even I don't even have an image of that. I'm not even
The image should
gonna.
be this image I have here. In fact, I'll paste it into chat, but this is what I'm looking at the moment. One second. It's just the plugin is the plugin is vulnerable flash thing which currently shows up when I look at things in Flash to update it.
Excellent. So that's pretty much what it is. I think they've done like two experimental things and...
Yeah, they want to have it working before they have all the cappers and snake tits touching it.
Exactly. But it's about the old XCOM, so less hype, obviously.
Mm.
Someone should do like a side, like a spin-off game about Valen. I would play that game.
This is her writing in her journal because everyone keeps telling her to shut up.
It's like Typing of the Dead, but Typing of Valen.
A Typing of Valen, yeah.
So, that's all we got about XCOM. That's pretty much it. Now we move on to the legal part of our show.
Hey.
Yeah. So the first legal item is about licenses and game licenses. So there's a pretty interesting article, I think, on RPS, linked in the description of the video if you're watching us on YouTube, about how good old games, or GOG or GOG, as mm-hmm. I like to call them, go about finding and posting and selling new games, or rather old games, but new as in like they're out of, they're not in retail anymore, so the people can't buy them. But they're like, oh, you remember this? I used to play this. This was cool. And then they dig out the guy who owns the rights. Yeah. They make a deal with them. And then the hardest part, apparently, is to find a actually decent code for this game. And the source codes are pretty rare because people don't really keep them and they disappear into the nothingness. And then they have to work from the actual game, the working whatever thing.
Yeah, reverse engineering, like the dodgy copy they got, which they then probably have to get special hardware to play, and then, it's a huge ball ache, it looks like.
Hence the image.
Very interesting read for that reason.
Mm. I recommend. We're not going to go into huge detail about it, but it's a pretty sizable article, and it's quite interesting if you're interested into old games and how they come back to life and make people money, strangely enough.
Yeah.
Again, even
I had an idea about this actually, that you could have a story where you're basically this guy investigating IP for games, and then you find out that like a bunch of them are being bought by this one person, and there's something common about all the games, and it's some like weird cult, and like the plot of the games is some like prophecy, and you eventually end up finding out what it is. And everyone's like, "What do you do?" And you're like, "I find IP for games from 1983," and they're like, "Okay," and then you end up in like this sort of spy fiction horror whatever.
Excellent. They have I saw recently an image. You know, they have the Museum of Games or whatever in somewhere in England now. I forgot where it was. They have like some pirated games that people like made the covers for themselves, like with with like markers and shit. It looks quite funny. Someone tweeted an image of that. They have like as an exhibit. So our speaking of UK, our next legal stuff is about UK. So they what is it called? The Consumer Rights Act, I think, has been updated to...
Consumer Rights Act.
Yeah, to include the, or better cover, digital stuff, including video games. So, interestingly enough, now, as of today, actually, if you find that your video game audio-visual experience isn't as described, you have 30 days to ask for a fix, which is obviously probably not going to happen in terms of video games, because I can't really repair them. At least the retailers can't repair them. But then the retailer, if they can't repair them, and probably they can't, they will have to give you the money.
Assuming you paid for it. There's no obligation to fix something that no one paid anything for.
Yeah. As long as the money has exchanged hands, then you have the right to ask for that in 30 days or within 30 days, even though it's a video game. Which is cool and new, and hopefully other countries around the world are going to do the same. Though, having said that, probably going to take a court case or two for like Sony and Nintendo to actually start paying attention. But yeah, I don't know. Because I mean, Steam and I think also, forgive me for mentioning this name, Origin, are already doing this kind of shit.
Nintendo is spending a bit more time making sure their shit works before they kick it out the door, but maybe now and they're even getting into the download age and less sort of strict quality controls, it may become relevant for them.
Yeah, potentially. But it has a terrible record of like refunds and
Warner
general...
Brothers are sweating, I bet.
Oh, no. Oh, God.
And Ubisoft are going, oh, no. Oh, fuck Rashid.
The fucking English again. Interesting. Another interesting point about this is Steam has only 2 hours usage and then you can refund. But with this now, you can actually go like, fuck you, 30 days and then refund. Or within 30 days and refund. So it actually goes kind of is broader than their policy. So it would be also interesting to know how they deal with this because...
Well, it's kind of like the two situations. Because with Steam, it's like, right... There's too much legalese and bullshit. We'll just give you the money back for any reason at all, under the 2 hours playtime.
Yeah.
Whereas this one is that period, but the reason has to be that it's busted.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, no. That makes sense. But it hasn't... I wonder if it has already happened today. Like, did someone bring in, like, one of those bottom feeder games? You know, the one at the last rated, like, 12% positive rating... Yeah. Like Bible games. Did anyone bring it back? And so like there was not enough Jesus in this. I'm sorry. Could I have the money back? I really need the £3 to buy Euro Millions.
And to which Steam would say, "Oh, we stock this."
Yeah. Every time that happens, Gabe has like a tingling sensation in his left ear. Which leads us to another thing about legal stuff. Oh yes, the strike. Did the strike happen?
I know that the most recent thing I heard about it was that lots of prominent voice actors were saying, I'm voting for it. So I wonder if the vote is happening. It hasn't happened yet.
Maybe the vote takes quite a bit of time. I don't know. So anyway, the voice actors are striking. Why are they striking, Ed?
Well, they're striking because generally the contracts for voice actors have been for a long time based on... They kind of were written like in the 90s. And have kind of stayed kind of out of date. And what's happened now is because the environment has changed where voice actors is becoming more important and motion capture is becoming viable for games and these old contracts don't really fit very well. A lot of people are getting fucked out of money and ending up doing things they don't want to do. For example, well, one of the things is apparently some people were having problems where they... were kind of being roped into mocap that they didn't necessarily agree to because the broadness of the voice actor contracts where, you know, you have a professional who just uses their voice and showing up and they're like, yeah, we need to now mocap you, and they're like, what? And also things like they wanted, one of the sticking points is they wanted more options to have bonus pay on extremely like well-selling games so that they could work on smaller projects, not get paid so much up front. Maybe they blow up and they get paid more at the end. Just more things like this. I think there's a lot of reasonable sounding demands on there, and pretty much every voice actor I've heard of has been going, yeah, sounds like a good idea, should probably do this.
So why the mo-cupping? Why are they doing motion capture for voice actors?
Well, games like Last of Us and Until Dawn and things like that have make extreme use of... capture in terms of acting, motion capture, matching the actor, doing the voice thing. So you capture the whole performance in one go. You've got markers on the face, you've got the body, you've got everyone in the room on set, and their cutscenes are done in that way. And it's a really effective way of doing it, especially if your technology for converting that information into... Like, if you've seen any like Last of Us Until Dawn stuff, that's it being done like at the kind of the forefront of technology. And it's really cool. But it's an entirely different ask to hire someone for that than someone to deliver lines for a guard or whatever.
Okay.
And I think some people were running into problems where they, you know, like getting contracts that were inappropriate to what they were thinking they were going to be doing and things like that.
Okay, cool. The one thing I found in there that I thought, I don't know, maybe that is fine in certain contexts, but the one demand that I always kind of... This is not the first time, obviously, I came across something like that, is when they want everyone who works to be the member of the union.
Oh, yeah, I heard about this.
Yeah, which is always kind of like, but...
Yeah, there were one or two things that were a little, like, creepy. And another thing was, one of the demands was that studios couldn't hire... from outside the union, like couldn't just have somebody in the studio do voices.
Yeah, exactly. And that was Yeah, what if like I have my own whatever voice? For some reason, my programmer is good at voice. I don't know. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. I mean, like it's extremely realistic, especially in like the game jam culture that we're kind of on the fringes of. Like to do your own sound effects, and when does a sound effect become a voice? Recently, yeah. Flambeer won like a Dutch game award for sound, and that was like Yukio and Junus over there, and Junus just goes wah, wah, wah. He's in the game, he's the voice. Although interestingly, they are, this is a bit of a tangent, but they are hiring someone to be the voice of Rogue.
Okay, are you applying?
No, they want a black woman, so I'm not applying.
Oh, I didn't realize she was black, actually.
Yeah, Rogue.
Yeah. I knew it was a she, but I didn't realize she was black. Okay, so from the strikes and black rogues, we go to songs, actually. So some more sounds. Probably like a few months from here, you're going to see a lot of happy birthday being sung in all kinds of media, because it has finally been freed from the blood-drenched clutches of Warner, evil corporation of Warners.
Yeah,
well, that's their full name, really. I'm not really making this up. No. So, Happy Birthday is, I guess, is it public domain now?
It is public domain now. If only this could happen to a song that was good.
So, the ruling was interesting as well, because what the judge said, and he said that the copyright that was registered in 1931 or whatever was for a specific rendition of the song, like a specific way of playing or whatever, performing it, not the song itself. And they've been, but the funny bit is that they've been like collecting money for this, and they estimated at $2 million a year. The entire time, where now it turns out that they didn't have the copyright, like the copyright was misattributed to them. So
what happens now?
I don't know. I mean, I assume that if I were to like say, if I was a company who paid like $500,000 to them or whatever, you know, what, $50,000 something last year for for the right to sing this, and now it turns out it's not really theirs, I'd be like, hey, can I get this back?
Yeah, goddamn.
Yeah.
That's nuts. Oh boy.
Mm.
I don't know.
So pretty interesting. I don't know if it's retroactive. I mean, again, law is strange, especially in America. So
yeah.
Who knows? This is kind of the last of the law for this show, and now we go to the void. I put the void in the middle.
Yeah, good idea.
Yeah,
because it is a hole, so it should go in.
Yeah, the yeah. So everything. Did you see that? Like, there's a GIF recently about how many like a mass of a black hole, and in the number of suns that like it would correspond to in terms of the way our sun. So
really?
It goes on like for like 20 seconds, like stacking massive
amounts. I thought that was just a joke. I thought that was like 20 billion suns looks like this, and it was just like for no reason. It was just
no. That's
like,
just the mass of a black hole, I think.
Oh damn.
Yeah, because it's been cool. Like eating shit for a long time now, and all the shit has mass. So, mass brings us to, where is this thing? This. Again, remember when the people who made, what was the game? Axiom something, what was it
called?
Soul Axiom. They also made, like, other stuff, like Gravity Badgers. It's very popular, maybe.
It's a very British-sounding video game name.
Yeah, in some circles it's quite popular. Anyway, so they shared a story of how a unknown but very famous YouTuber approached them and asked them to do, pay them to, for the YouTuber would do some videos where they would be, I think, mentioned, not even like just them. Because this is the entire text of it, and I think it's quite interesting. So I'm just going to read out. So on one of my normal PR rounds, this is the developer from, what is the studio called? I forgot. Well, anyway, the guys who made Soul Axiom, those guys, they have like tons of games. Wales Interactive, there you go. So on one of my normal PR rounds, I received an email from a very popular YouTuber with a few million subscribers. There aren't that many with that, by the way. So you can narrow it down to like 30 people.
Oh, we should do that, because I'm shocked, by the way, that no one knows who this is.
Oh,
that's the most interesting part of this to me, is that they didn't drop the name. That seems like weird.
Yeah.
Unheard of, almost.
Anyway, maybe they were like worried that they'd get sued by them. Maybe it's Total Biscuit, and they would be like, I'm afraid of the top hat. But he was like objectively asking for this, so it's fine. So very popular YouTuber with a few million subscribers offering to have one of our games featured on their YouTube channel for a rate of either, and I, this is the part I enjoy the most, the pricing, the price list. For either 17,600 dollars for two or three, which one? I mean, this is a lot of money we're talking about.
It's supposed to be an American then.
Yeah, I guess. Well, I mean, Tolbisky lives in America. For two or three talking points, or 22 grand for two or three talking points and a description link, the tester wrote. So
I would say a description link is worth $4,400.
So in the light of this this event, I would like to announce that I will, you know, feature your game on our channel. But it's a bit more complicated than what this guy has here, or you know what John Bain has here mentioned. So, if I don't like your game, it's gonna be $5 for two or three talking points, or $7 for for two or three talking points and the description link. But if I do like your game, then it's going to be $150 for two or three talking points and $250 with the description link. The reason is obviously because I have to stay objective, and I need the money kind of helps me with that. So, you know, because if I like it, I'll be like biased toward the game, and we don't want that. My audience really trusts me to be completely objective about this, so I would have to like get a bit of extra if it's any good. But if it's,
well,
it's not
actually,
very good.
To keep it balanced, what we're going to do is have, regardless of how you feel about it, I will get one of the two or three talking points, so either 50% or 33% of it, and I will take the opposite view to Andro.
Oh, that's a very good idea. That's a very good idea. We should definitely do that. I'm going to start approaching every developer's email I can find. Like, just email everybody.
We'll do it like the BBC. We'll have, like, a mass murderer on one side, and then, like, a scientist on the other side, and then we'll say, who's right?
What is that show called where they have that?
Like the American version of that, like the Fox one?
No. They have that BBC show where they have a lot of people sitting in a room and they talk, and then someone's like, "No, female genital mutilation is fine," and the other one's like, "Oh, you are terrible."
No, I don't know.
Anyway,
I can see it in my head, but I can't remember.
Speaking of horror. So yeah. I'm gonna let you talk about this one. Remember this guy?
I don't see the picture yet. You got a nice picture of him?
Yeah, I got the picture Hamus made. Hey Hamus, what's up?
I love that image so much. So you know, you go through life and you grow up, you're a kid, then you become a young adult, and you start off as most people start off, kind of an idealist. You think that people are essentially good. And but there are, you know, some bad people in the world, and you think it's a good versus evil thing in very simple black and white terms, very Western movie kind of thing. But you eventually grow out of it. And so when you look at the news and you see something that's so black and white, you see a character that is so obviously almost designed. It seems like he's been designed by a team of artists at Disney. Like, we're making a new animated film. We need the most disgusting, despicable person representing all the worst aspects of capitalism ever. Can you please do me a drawing of that? It's very surprising when you see that, and that's what we're seeing now. So there's this guy, and his name is Martin Shrekley?
Yeah.
His name is Shrek. That's literally his name. And basically, this guy... we probably would have talked about it anyway, but he happens to own a League of Legends team. So, you know, he's not scoring any points there either. So he's an ex-hedge fund manager. Presumably he cut the hedge and put pavement there instead.
Parking lot.
Yeah, just parking for his Segway. He basically is now CEO for a pharmaceutical, and... essentially what this company seems to do, or appears to do, and has done multiple times, this what we're talking about is only the most recent incidents of it, is buy patents for drugs that are going out of some kind of period, I believe, some patent period, or just like no one really cares anymore who has it. The drugs have become generic, and these are like very important drugs. So I think there's some of them more important than others, obviously, but in this case, what we're talking about is, what's the exact name of it? Daraprim, which is a drug used to treat toxoplasmosis, and is used in the treatment of HIV and various other things. He's taken the patent for this, which was a generic drug, which was sold at $1,350 per pill, which I believe you had to take, maybe this is a daily thing or something, I can't remember exactly, I don't think I see it on here. Regardless, that changed from a price that you could afford, $1,350, to $750, which is in a lot of places, if you're lucky, what you'll get in a couple of weeks or a month, as far as income goes. So then he, basically people found out about this, this came out, and people also found out that he'd taken lots of pictures of him looking like a cock. there's him on this like little scooter Segway thing. There's him on a chessboard, like it angled up, and looking like a cock. There's him like at a party, looking like a cock. There's a couple of others doing the rounds. This is the thing. It's like they paid a professional photographer. They're like, we need some mood board images for these Disney animators who are designing this terrible person. Give me something that give me the feel for this monster. So essentially this kind of came out, people were understandably angry and like, what the fuck, because this is going to fuck over a ton of people. So he went on a what some people charitably referred to as a charm offensive and appeared on a couple of like talk shows, including USA Today, and there's a video you can look up, I don't know if it's in the links. There's a CNBC video where he's basically being interviewed about it, and he kind of flashes his disgusting smile and talks in approximation of a human language about why what he's doing is actually really helping out people with this life-saving drug who deserve better than this life-saving drug, and so have raised the price to $750 a pill so that they can do research into making another pill that does the same thing.
Yeah. In case you haven't done the math, that's a 5,500% hike in price. When I heard like, oh, it's $1,350, I was like, that's kind of expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, some of these things you only take like infrequently, or the course is quite short or whatever. But yeah, as far as I know, the course for this shit is long. Like, this is used for treating malaria as well. Like, that takes a while to shake.
Yeah,
that's not a trivial thing.
I wonder how much that actually, because I there's another thing that I never really figured out is like, does this affect the price of the drug in other countries, or is it just USA only? Because people don't really seem to mention that. But
I don't know. I have had this kind of conversation with some other people who also never followed through. So we were like, I don't know. Yeah, but I believe just from my like very limited knowledge that this only seems to apply in the USA, but I'm not certain.
Mm.
One thing was that Hillary Clinton was like, fuck that.
Yeah, and, she was.
She tweeted. So she tweeted it. And she was just like, yeah, that's not really on.
She's like, if I'm president, I'm coming after you. You know how Barack killed Osama? Like, I'm going to do that.
Kill this motherfucker.
Yeah.
I'm going to put a bomb in his little Segway scooter. So after a week or so of this, I believe that he backed down on it, and it's actually returning to the $1,350 price, which, like, yay, well done, everybody, but there's tons of other drugs that this has been done on. There's tons of drugs this will continue to happen to. There won't be a media outrage for every single one of these. It's pretty awful. And the only takeaway from this, which is good, is if you ever find yourself stuck in a conversation with somebody who's arguing why libertarianism is a good thing, you can just link them to this article. You could just post a picture that Hamish drew of him riding over that pile of skulls, and they won't be able to say anything. This is like the most like clear cut. This is horrible thing I maybe ever seen in my adult life.
Is it confirmed that he returned the price to $1,350? Because he said, we are reducing it, but he didn't say how much. And I tried to look it up. No one mentions how much. it costs or will cost now, but yeah, I don't know. It kind of...
I don't know, but I thought I'd heard it was returning to its original price.
Okay, because the global attention of the media consumers kind of went like, oh, look, the other stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, like, there was some serious other stuff. I mean...
Yeah, we're going...
That pig's not going to fuck itself.
We're getting there. Before we get to the pig is after this one. other evil, because we are still in the void section of our show, just to remind you guys. So this is other kind of void, which is the operating system we all have to use at some point, I guess.
One day.
Yeah, so remember that time, because this was like 2 weeks ago, when Windows 10 decided to download itself onto every computer without asking
you? Oh, you mean last week?
Was it last week? Okay, there you go. I hope you all appreciate the image I found for Windows 10. This was not easy to find. So this is not you didn't have to like reserve the right to whatever to install Windows 10. At some point they were like, fuck it, not enough people reserved Windows 10, let's just download anywhere. So I haven't updated my computer in like 3 weeks, and I don't think I downloaded, because I have it set on like don't download on by your
manually do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, so. No, I've got it sitting here ready to go. I was considering making a GIF where I see the little window in the bottom corner of my screen, then I pull out a handgun and shoot a hole into my monitor exactly where that is.
We know what we should do. We should have like a party where we just get really drunk and until that point where we like ready to install Windows 10. It's like a Windows 10 party.
Footage documentary horror.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Like Windows 10, and we just get hammered and then try and put it in.
We could die from like too much blood alcohol. So yeah, be wary of that. Probably cancel like automatic updates or whatever. If you're like on a laptop somewhere.
There are like update numbers you can look up where you can uninstall. Like the thing, I recently reset my firewall to check like everything that was coming in and kind of look it up. And there was one that was called GXW. I looked it up and it says get Windows 10. And I was like, all right, I'll block that. And as soon as I blocked that, another one came up saying it was like looking for GXW updater. I was like, well, let me block that. So there's actually code which, if it doesn't hear from its buddy GXW, will go, GXW, buddy?
JSW will be like, if my friend doesn't hear from me every 24 hours, he will send a package to every media outlet in this country.
No, you know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of Texas Chainsaw Massacre, where they one by one go into the house, and the guy just kills them, and they're like, JSW? And they're like,
That could be like a very enticing image. Just the guy from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre with Windows 10 t-shirt.
Reserve yours today.
And then in the end of the clip he says, it's free! Yep.
Okay.
Alright, are we ready for this? This is the main thing in the show. I have like 10 images of pigs and the Prime
Excellent.
Minister in the same one. Alright, here we go. Let's do this. Remember when David Cameron fucked a pig?
Yes.
Yeah. So that was pretty cool. That news broke a few days ago, and he's in my heart. He is still and always will be David Cameron, the man who copulated with a dead pig to fit in.
Did you know he tweeted today?
What about the pigs?
He just tweeted. That's not what I'm talking about, though, because you click on the tweet, then you get to see what people say.
It's just pig fucker all the way down, though.
Hang on, let me just read an extract. Pig, fuck off dish face. Why is the rum gone? Legalize weed then, fam. And Yeah, mostly it's just like pig. Actually, it's weird. It was worse earlier, pig shagger. Please give Dave a chance. Oh, there's a great image of Obama on the phone to him. He says, Mr. President, can you hear me? And then Obama says, yes, David, but there's some crackling on your end. And then David Cameron looking sad. Please continue.
I just want the slideshow to run, really. Yeah. don't really have to speak. It's fine.
So one thing about all of this is that to some people this has been a little confusing.
Really?
Yeah. So to some people this has been a bit confusing because they see it in the framing of this is a person in public eye, and someone said something embarrassing about them, and now everyone's being mean to them. Now, if you frame it like that, you go, okay, this is, like, really unfair, like, this is a double standard, you'd be complaining if you did this to someone else. But the thing that I think people who, coming from that angle, need to understand is that it is significantly different to any other situation like that because of several reasons. The first is that David Cameron is the definition of a public person. He was sort of voted in by British people.
Majority.
Yeah, the majority of 24.4% of voting adults. So this is the person who is the most on the hook for anything in this country and should be held to account. And this actually relates to his rise to power in that the implication is that he stuck his dick in the head of a decapitated pig at a rich kids club in order to sort of secure support to get him into power, which he now is. Now, imagine if you'd done all that and you didn't become the prime minister, you'd be kind of pissed off.
Well, I'm glad he's happy at least. That he's not very pissed off because he'd fucking the pig paid off.
Yeah, the thing is as well that another thing you could say is, you know, these are allegations, it's unfair, this guy has been libeled, to which I would respond, it actually doesn't matter whether he did or didn't do this, whether this is actually a rumor. Because, like, what we're talking about is the kind of person he is. Everyone in their heart in the UK, like, believes this could have happened and doesn't care if it did or didn't. I think that's what's actually true, is because you see in the articles, like, usually you've got your right-wing people defending all this weird shit in comments, and it's not generally people saying this is bullshit, no, there's no evidence of it. It's people saying, ah, kids will be kids, right? And you're like, no, hold on. Like, what? Like, people, there have been loads and loads of, like, screen caps of these comments as well. Like, people defending doing this. And technically, no laws were broken. I'm just glad the pig was dead. Or maybe it didn't happen. But if it did, I'm just glad the pig was dead. Because that would have been really, truly awful. The thing is that we can all imagine that he could do something like this. And the really sad thing is, as well, even though we know he probably did this, we know also that he's still going to be in power for the next 5 years. This isn't actually going to change anything. It's really us getting fucked, because you can apparently fuck a pig and still run this country. Or not, or whatever, who knows, allegedly. And there's a couple of links that will be attached to this from one of the blogs is Obsolete, one that I read a lot of, and one is the New Statesman, Laurie Penny, writes about it, where she sort of goes a bit more into kind of my perspective on this, and I agree with her on pretty much everything there, is that the rage that people felt, or like kind of the cathartic rage that people felt on like those 2 days when it broke, and I was there on Twitter on that evening when it broke, and it was like Christmas.
And people eat pork on Christmas quite a lot.
Yeah. Mm. So yeah, the thing is that anger that people felt at him that day is what people should be directing to him for the things that he is doing in official power. Like, the shit that he's fucking done the last 5 years and the shit we're going to have to put up with for the next 5 years is so depressingly maddening that everyone's, like, become so, like, numb to it that he'll announce another thing, like more benefits to be cut for children and disabled people and stuff. And you just kind of, this is a very British thing to go, oh, well, that's happening. And then it carries on. So what I really liked about this was that even though it was kind of absurd, it sort of, for a day, like, shocked people out of that state of just misery that's extremely British. And instead, were put into kind of the mode of also extremely British, jeering at somebody falling. although at the same time, it was like the end of a Greek tragedy, kind of. It was just the word catharsis is probably, if I had to sum it up in one word, that entire like couple of days was just catharsis. So that's the thing. I don't care if he did or not. I'm just very happy to be laughing at this fucker who has spent his entire life laughing at me and everybody in this country. There you go.
Lena's take on this was that they made it themselves for the catharsis, so people kind of get relieved about conservatives. They laugh at it, and they'll be like, oh, I can't, I mean, whatever, he fucked the pig, I don't give a shit, the guy, whatever. And then they just leave him do his shit. So, like, his PR department actually was like, all right, let's, we have a couple of pig shots through the last 5 years, let's put them to good use. What do the kids call it nowadays? Ah, the memes. Yeah, the memes gonna meme out, and...
Oh, man.
Next election is gonna be fun, though. It's gonna be the pig fucker against the turbo nerd.
I thought the last one was the pig fucker versus the turbo nerd. This one, the problem is that Jeremy Corbyn, the only problem with Jeremy Corbyn is he's gradually turning into a bronze statue of someone with integrity. Eventually he'll completely freeze up and we'll all just eat sandwiches beneath him and be like, wow, they don't make people like that anymore.
He won't be able to ride his Chairman Mao bicycle anymore. No, but...
Up to the irn-bru factory.
Yeah, exactly. He said that he's going to go to Scotland every month now.
Cool.
Yeah.
He really needs them.
Yeah. So, but it's... No, I think the previous elections, or the last elections, was pigfucker against the dork, but this is going to be the pigfucker against the turbo nerd.
Okay, dork versus... Dork is the old one, turbo nerd's the new one.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, yeah. Have you seen...
Assuming Cameron runs, I think he will, but...
Oh, actually,
not,
no,
like
he said he
Boris.
Won't. Oh, he said he won't, though.
Oh, he said he won't?
Yeah, he said that if you elect me this time, this is my last time, I promise. He actually said that. But maybe he'll be like, nothing changed.
Yeah, said he'd fuck off, so...
Yeah, well, I mean, you know that he would not do that, definitely. But he, I mean, Cameron may fuck off, because he's probably tired by now of this, all this shit. Like, yeah. I'd imagine that you know, he's probably enjoying part of this, but he's also probably really... stressed out at this point, because you know, so there's a like.
I imagine it's a fairly stressful job.
Certain amount of, I mean, like hatred. Certain amount of hatred that you are is directed at you is just kind of probably wears you down at some point. Like you would, you know, even if it's justified, it
well,
probably.
I mean, if we can help wear him down quicker,
let's do it.
let's go.
But did you see Corbyn's what was it called, acceptance or first speech at the first conference since he's the leader?
No, I didn't see it.
The jokes he made is like, oh god, does he also play with miniatures?
Oh. Oh no.
The jokes are like, okay, cool. I mean, at least we'll have a nerd leader. Maybe it's kind of
I think,
a,
you know,
a change.
Maybe he's just applying. Maybe he's appealing to dads because he's like, right, I've got the kids. I've got every fucker ever voted fucking Green and Lib Dem. I don't even need to bother anymore.
Maybe,
occasionally,
yeah.
I'll do something that's not horrible. Now I need to get the people who like model trains. I need to get the people who like Warhammer Fantasy. I need to get the people
Dark
Horse.
He's really going for them, though. Yeah, just watch like first 5 minutes, and he's like making fun of people saying shit about him in the newspapers, and it's like, ah,
oh,
Jeremy.
Oh, I did read these quotes. I read those quotes. And okay. They looked a bit flaccid.
They yeah, but the delivery is also because he also like stumbles a couple of times and makes kind of like, kind of, you know, the kind of raise my glasses back on my nose type of.
Oh man, well maybe though in like negotiations with like others. That can put them off, and he can get more out of it than he you know bargained for. Just
maybe.
Be like telling a terrible knock knock joke to Putin, and Putin's like, "I don't get it." And he turns to consult the cat that's in the CRT, and the cat's like, "Ah." By which time, you know, we've taken like we've made the Eurovision Song Contest that much bigger.
Excellent. There was also the article about like the Corbyn's going to cause nuclear holocaust because he doesn't want the nuclear holocaust today in. Because one of the Labour members, party members, was like, oh no, he's going to cause the nuclear holocaust because he said, I'm not going to press the button. Did you see that there's a really cool Yes Prime Minister thing where they discuss exactly this?
That one's great. He's like, no, the one where the guy says you should invest in a conventional military. He's like, oh, I just got a nuke.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that it's episode's really amazing.
Which leads us to Peeple. Peeple. Which could be a hoax.
Yeah, this is the thing. It could be not real.
But if it's not a hoax, it is a upcoming service.
Yeah.
Not a product, service. coming out in November, if it's not a hoax, where you'll be able to rate people. Rate people. Like you rate restaurants or, I don't know.
Uber drivers, eBay sellers.
Yeah. What I don't understand about their model, if it is true, is are you meant to, like, do you need to be part of this? Like, do I need to log in to be rated?
No, anyone can be rated. Although apparently if you don't have an account, they are claiming that only positive ratings will show up. So they obviously will have to define what positive is in a block of text. so apparently all they need is to have your phone number to confirm that it's you. I'm not really sure how this verification works, but and also that's not sufficient. So they take that, they give you some rating. I believe you maybe get some star rating, but I believe there's also qualitative description as well. It just seems to be... I don't know what it's for, except for its sort of unstated purpose of revenge.
Yeah, no, I don't really understand it, because that's why I kind of hope... that it is a hoax, it's or a joke or whatever, because it will not work on any level. It will immediately be abused. Their negative thing is if you get a negative comment, they say we give you not they're not gonna deal with this. They give the person who is receiving the negative comment 48 hours to review with this and potentially and challenge it. What if I'm like away?
Like, what? Or what if, like, fuck this entirely?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Why am I
You can't take it down because they say it will undermine the point of the entire system. To which I go, huh?
Like, why am I even supposed to, like, acknowledge anyone writing... not that anyone's going to write anything negative about me, because obviously I am perfect.
Well, yeah. You've got that going for you. Yeah, least, so but... You're safe. You have people privilege.
I'm just worried about, you know, the less what's the word? Privileged, nice. Yeah, people than me.
As one thing that's been kind of going on in the background, which is also kind of been lending a little bit to, I don't know, you could take it as evidence that it's real or not, depending on how you argue it. There's more information about it, is that people have been trolling the fuck out of them. Like, people made, like, fake Twitter accounts that imitated these people. And people have been posting, like, super negative comments on their Facebook, which have supposedly they've been deleting.
Yeah. That's against the rules, I'm sorry.
Yeah, and they've been tweeting like, fuck you, fuck this, like sort of like being really aggressive towards people personally contacting them, and sort of behaving in really weird, sort of irrational way, although it kind of, like, you're being attacked, you lash out, in a way it's rational, or at least an expected human reaction. So they just sort of seem to be getting a taste of what their service is about to maybe offer to millions of people. And they seem to be taking it quite poorly. I don't get it.
Are the two women who appear in all the pictures, you know, the CEO and the co-CEO or whatever, are they real people?
Nicole McCullough and Julia Corday?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Because if they're, okay, if they're not real people, someone must have by now complained, hey, that's me in the picture.
Yeah, oh, I see. Like, it was some stock photo or some random bar thing.
Yeah, if they are them, like, their names correspond to the faces, then we need to figure out, we need to, like, see. If we were to, like, research this, you'd be like, okay, have they ever done anything like this? What is their...
Yeah, what's what their do we know? CV? Are they on LinkedIn? Yeah.
Would they like to... What do people do on LinkedIn?
I would like to add you to my professional network on LinkedIn.
There's another thing where you... what do you do? You do, like, you recommend someone, you...
Endorse.
Endorse, yeah.
Would like to endorse them for social media.
Or be endorsed by them, then I would be very popular in social media.
Man, that shit used to mean something, because you'd actually have to write something, so it was like one of those proper recommendations that you give to someone that helps them get a job.
Yeah.
And then they just changed it to, like, tags. So it was like, some random guy I never met was like, endorsed me for 3D and compositing, and I'm like, I don't do compositing. What the fuck are you talking about? And it just has absolutely no value. Like, they should change that motto on LinkedIn. I don't know what their current motto is. Nobody does, because they don't go to LinkedIn. They just get email notifications. It should say, LinkedIn, no value.
That's kind of what it says now, without saying. It's like between the lines. Isn't LinkedIn like just a joke now, though? It's like, it's just whatever. People, yeah. I've never heard anyone be like, yeah, LinkedIn's pretty good. Everyone's like, oh god, I was there once, and oh boy.
You know what LinkedIn is? It's like you're at a party, and you're all wearing like suits, but if you look closely, the suits are all kind of threadbare, and you're all standing in little circles, and somebody says to you, oh, can I have your card? And you say, yes, and you reach into your pocket, but there's a hole in your pocket, and you realize the bottom of the lining of your jacket is weighed down by 2 kilos of business cards, and you reach in, and you're like, and you take one out, and it's someone else's business card, but you've just gone to the trouble of pulling this out of your jacket lining, so you hand it to them like this, and they're like, thanks, and then they put it in the hole in their pocket, and it just falls onto the pile of business cards in there, and then you like shake hands and turn and go into the next little huddle of people, and that's what LinkedIn is.
And then you realize that everyone has the same problem. Like, everyone has this weight that they carry in their jacket, and everyone's kind of hunched down, like the shoulders kind of limping down. Well, that alternate scenario is where you put your hand in the lining, and you can't, something's tugging it down into between your jacket and the lining. There's something there.
You get pulled into your jacket.
Yeah, something is alive in there. Oh god, won't anyone help you? Which leads us to this guy who made another ad block.
Oh yeah, this guy.
Yeah, but then he was like, nah fam, and he pulled it down. That's that's the entire, it was called Peace, because it was meant to give you peace.
This was for Apple stuff, right?
Yeah, from iOS. Peace from ads. Mm-hmm. But then he got like number one page, made a couple of mil, and then he was like, this is wrong. What I did is wrong. It's not what I want to do with my life. And he pulled it from there.
It was exactly like Flappy Bird in that regard.
Yeah. Except that Flappy Bird wasn't doing anything bad.
Yeah, so this guy was getting money for an ad blocker. Now, like, I'm fine with ad blockers generally. I understand why they exist. Getting money for it is, like, that crosses the line and goes somewhat beyond it. That's kind of gross. So, good job that you pulled it down, I guess. It's sort of been in, like, a lot of people, maybe this was what sparked it, but recently a lot of people have been talking about ad blockers again. It seems to come up every year or so, or every few months, and then there are lots of think pieces and things. What do you think about it?
I agree with, who said it? It was, I think it was a poll from the Mode 7 games, the Mad poll. He said, the think piece sounds like an insult. And then I think Bennett, the guy who made Quop, was like, because it often is.
Oh, you have to loop me to that exchange. That sounds amazing.
So that's, I agree. I agree with that. Adblocks in general, I mean, I kind of understand what he did and why he did it. Sort of. I don't know if I would ever make an ad blocker. It's hard for me to imagine myself in a position that he's holding, because I don't know. It's kind of, it's the kind of thing. It's like, oh, what if you were a chef at a restaurant? Yeah, I guess.
I'm not a chef. Yeah. I don't know. I don't
even go to restaurants that often. But hey. So yeah. I don't know. Like, this whole ad block thing, it has to come to some kind of end and conclusion, or because it's still kind of in development in terms of, like, it's still a struggle between those who want to get paid through ads and those who don't want to see the ads, and obviously the system isn't really working that well, so hopefully there will be some kind of thing developing.
is the amount of revenue you get from ads is getting to the point that it's sort of it's getting to the point where it doesn't matter if somebody uses ad block or not, because I don't think that's the main drain on it. I think it's the fact that there's so many people making stuff, when that's obviously a good thing, but it's coming to the point where you may want to consider sort of catering to a niche audience who will kind of directly pay for the things that they want to see that you're making, versus a catch-all thing where you have to put up with really obnoxious things that don't apply to you in any way, and you wouldn't want them to apply to you because that would mean trackers and things and everything you do, just irrelevant shit and annoying stuff, and having to sit through it because you like the creator. You don't want to be the creator asking someone to watch shit, and you don't want to be the person watching shit, but you also don't want to be the person stealing, not really stealing, but you know what I mean, shit.
Yeah.
It's kind of a lose-lose situation unless you come up with some other technology to deal with this problem.
It still matters, though, for those people who, like, ask $17,500 for, like, two or three gig points. Because if your video gets, like, you know, 500,000 views, you probably make, I don't know, $5,000 to $10,000 from that video through crappy ads and crappy ad revenue through sheer mass of the people that see it.
Yeah,
so for them, like, whether or not half of the people use adblock means, like, they get either $5,000 or $2,500, and there's a pretty decent
amount.
It affects
the size of their house.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So can they get the really big yacht, or just the kind of the
like that South Park episode about MP3s? You remember that one? It's like, oh, I had to downgrade my jet, and everyone's like,
Exactly,
like, the people you want to protect first in this are the people who, like, where it would mean the difference between being able to survive or not.
Yeah.
Like, when it comes to, like, top hat wearing cunts, whatever, get bent. A percentage of people aren't going to pay you. But, yeah, you really want... This is the thing as well. The only thing that annoys me about this argument is when someone doesn't follow it through the conclusion and just goes... Oh, just watch ads. You're like, well, but ads are obnoxious. Trackers are bad. That you're just not addressing it. Or people are like, I'll just block everything. Like, well, that's a bit short-sighted.
Yeah.
But other than that, you know, whatever.
So anyway, we'll see in a couple of years where this goes, because it probably will go somewhere. There was that service that I think Google was trying to introduce, and I don't know if there was a follow-up on that, where they were essentially doing
YouTube
their own
thing.
No, the tip jar? No, I mean, that's one thing, but there's also... overall, like, website thing, not specific to a platform, where Google was, like, essentially doing their own Patreon.
Yeah. What was it called? It wasn't called TipJar. It was called, like, I can't remember. I was looking at it the other day, and it's not available here yet.
Yeah, it's only in America in some places, blah, blah. No, TipJar is YouTube only, and it's also available only in America, and I think, Germany or Australia or something like that. But anyway, we'll see where that takes us. We're done with the void, so everybody rejoice or lament, whatever. I mean,
we didn't talk about the dislike button, but I think because that's not really happening, we can just.
Did I not do that?
No, we didn't do the Facebook dislike button.
Oh, because that I put it in there. Where did I put it?
I got it here in the tab.
Wait. How did I miss the dislike button? Because I may have it in a different kind of section of this. Or maybe
I
don't.
It would be void.
Yeah, no, anyway, dislike button is coming to Facebook.
No, it isn't.
What? What do you mean?
So this actually was a popular misconception that basically was based off a quote of Zuckerberg. He said, I don't want it to just be thumbs up. There should be more ways of expressing stuff. Where is the exact quote? I can't find it anymore, but it was... I can't find it. But essentially, I think what they're doing is making like a bunch of icons that are slightly more detailed than just the thumbs up. So there's like a few other ways to express something. But he explicitly said we didn't want to just build a dislike button because we don't want to turn Facebook into a forum where people are voting up or down on people's posts. Which is basically a long way of saying Reddit. That doesn't seem like the kind of community we want to create. So he actually has debunked the idea that it's just slap on a dislike. That's not what it's going to be. I mean, none of this matters to any of us.
Yeah.
But this just happens to be the thing.
Sure, but then what is it going to be?
I imagine, just from like what he's been saying, I don't have the quote now, but I saw it earlier and I was like, oh, okay, that seems what it was, is that it's going to be a range of
like things you can do. It looks just like you could put like a face there, maybe, or something. Things that are just a bit more detailed. So it's like, you know, maybe a thumbs up, maybe a okay, maybe something like that. I don't know. But it's not just going to be one number, a favorite star like in Twitter or anything like that. And it's not going to be up down like on YouTube. It's going to be something else. But
yeah, no, I remember the idea was that say if someone posts like, oh, my grandfather just died, and then he was like, well,
it addresses that problem.
Yeah, then he was like, oh, giving a like to that, it was like, yeah, fucking cunt is finally dead. But what you want to say is like, oh, but but then like you obviously can't type because you have no hands, so you just want to express that with a click. And
the problem, Andro, though, with having a condolences emoticon instead of like, you know, the thumbs up, thumbs down, is of course you have the instance where someone gets married and you give them condolences.
Because you know it's going to happen. That's as soon as you give people choices, they're going to get creative with them and like then
and offensive.
It's, I don't know. To a certain degree, that's the price you pay for letting, you know, people have language. I don't know.
I mean, we're talking about a platform where mums yell about abortion. That's all Facebook is. It's mums posting pictures of fetuses to each other. That's all it is.
That is pretty close. Yeah, I agree. There's also like some lame parties being advertised as well.
Please come to this place at this time.
Yeah.
And there's like 100,000 people said maybe, and you're like, oh god, they're not coming.
You want to talk about Street Fighter?
Let's talk about Street Fighter.
All right, we're in the fighting games category.
Okay,
boom.
Cool.
So I put all the three videos of new characters together, so take it away.
Cool. All right, great. Well, since we're coming out of the void, I thought I'd start with Rashid. So Rashid got announced. He's a brand new character, one of the four brand new characters they're doing in the roster of 16, I believe. And so no one's seen him before. He has lots of wind type attacks. He spirals around a lot. He seems to have kind of like dive kicks, he's got a dodge roll for dealing with projectiles and stuff. It generally looks like a very fun movement character. And he was announced in Dubai. They had a game show on the 11th of September. This is sort of a trend of, it seems to be this campaign's trend is that they will go to a game show in a country and then release a character that's specifically for that country. So at E3, that was when Ken came out. And then here at this Dubai show, they brought out Rashid. And they recently were... what else? I'm sure there was a Japanese character came
Karen.
Out. Karen came out at a Japanese game show. And just, I believe it was today, Zangief.
Yeah.
Zangief came out, and he has been released for a Russian game show. So, in a way, knowing this, you should probably look at the shows that they'll be at in the next few weeks, and then look at Street Fighter Alpha series, and then see if you can cross-reference them. And you should be able to have a roadmap for the character coming out, because if you look at the lineup at the moment, pretty much all the old returning characters are from the Alpha series, so that includes Karen, that includes Armika, the wrestler, that includes Charlie from way back in the beginning. That aspect of it is somewhat interesting. So yeah, Rashid looks cool. So the last void thing I'll talk about is, so this Dubai game show happened on the 11th of September, or to you and me, 11-9, which is... apparently a very significant day in America, because if you have had a stroke and try to call the ambulance, you may type 11-9 into your phone and get nobody. So some people were like, an Arab? 11-9? November 9th? and basically were like, don't you think this is a little offensive? To which every reasonable person on the planet went, huh? And that's basically all I'll say about it. Fuck you, idiots.
You know, there's like three more news things that I checked the dates on the articles, and they're all on the 9th of 11th of September. And I was like...
Stuff still happens, apparently.
What was it? There was one thing that was pretty funny that was like, oh god, this came out on 9/11. But it was... I can't remember which news thing it was like. Maybe one of those that we already mentioned.
Yeah. There were a couple of articles right at the beginning I noticed. I just happened to notice they were then.
And how offensive is that Zangief isn't a Russian name?
Like, do you know where the name comes from?
I always assumed that he was Jewish, but
he could be Jewish Russian.
Maybe. Yeah. When I first found out that, because I thought like German, like because it's like a German-ish kind of name. A lot of Jews German Jews have like German sounding names. So I thought, and then I was like, oh, he's from Russia apparently. Okay, cool. Whatever.
All I know is that his character is Russian.
Mm. Yeah. Because he fights for Mother Russia.
He's had. What was it? His V skill was kind of cool, which was basically you hit it and then you hold a direction, and he's got that one hit of armor, but he kind of creeps along, like a bit like there was that one move in Street Fighter 4 where you can do that, where you do a 360 hit, I think punches or something like that, and he'll go and then follow you along.
Yeah. That was pretty cool.
So he's got that now, but I think you can control his direction, and he can absorb one hit. So basically, he becomes scary. Mm. So obviously, there'll be ways around it, but it's very in keeping with the character. It's very cool. So that's him. And then Karen, returning character, she seems to be very Wrecker-based. So basically, a bit like the fake Bruce Lee character. What was his name? What is his name? I can't even remember.
Something Lee? I don't know.
Damn it! What is the fake Bruce Lee character called?
I know.
You know who I mean.
Yeah.
But yeah, she seems to be very kind of straightforward on the ground, powerful forward hits, in succession, kind of Wrecker style character. I don't know how she plays. We did have a little go on Street Fighter 5 at EGX, actually, the beta.
And none of these guys though.
No, none of these ones were there. But we got to play some of the others. One thing that we both learned is fuck controllers. It was impossible to kind of get a feel for the game on a controller. It would have been great if they were like arcade machine fight sticks, but I can understand why that wasn't the case. They're really
they'd probably
the
steal
fact.
Them.
Well, yeah, they'd probably just get stolen, just like all those ones from Heart of Gaming. Actually, they just stole the TVs.
I think they just stole the TVs there.
Anyway, so those seem cool. Everything still seems good in Capcom land.
I don't know if they had this similar kind of character, but like, is it Karin, the one they revealed in Japan, I guess? Because she's like very upper class kind of. And she does one of the things she says before she starts fighting is, "Let me show you the divide between our classes."
That's so good. That's so good.
We have a lot of stuff in the fighting fighting game section here. So next one up is how shit the King of Fighters 14 looks.
Yeah, it looks bad. So
it looks
King of Fighters series, it's based on sprite art. Pretty much every fighting game was based on sprite art at some point, except for maybe like Soul Calibur Tech, and that kind of started in 3D already.
Yeah.
And Killer Instinct, I guess.
Did Tekken start in 3D?
Was that Tekken?
Did it start in 3D though? I think Tekken 1
was some horribly ugly 3D. Maybe. I believe it was on the PlayStation. I could be wrong, because the first one I played.
Because Tekken 3 was on PlayStation 1.
Oh, yeah. 2 and 3 were on PlayStation. I don't know about 1, I never played it, I never saw it. But
you tell the story, I'll look it up.
Okay, cool. But yeah, pretty much all fighting games that are like long-standing series, especially from Japan, were 2D sprites. Now, the thing that's special about KOF is that it features probably the most detailed sprites in a fighting game that exist. They look amazing, especially the most recent one, KOF 13. I believe they were actually made with 3D assistance, but it remains that they are actually sprite art finished. So they kind of, you know, probably started from models and then turned that into sprites. Anyway, they look amazing, and it's like a big hallmark of the series. So it's kind of sad now to see a really early trailer for KOF 14 in very bland looking 3D. It looks like late era PS2 kind of level stuff. It looks kind of at the level maybe Tekken Tag Tournament was at. Very bland looking versions of these otherwise characterful characters as well. They look like they could just be in some K-pop band and have.
They probably are.
Maybe they are. Who knows?
But they have a silhouette around them. If you look at, because the one guy, he did like a slow mo version of this, and the characters, because they do like very fast change of scene. They actually have like as if they were cut out in the, like if you do on a Photoshop, if you do like a selection with this selection tool, that kind of gets like a bit more pixels around. Yeah, as if like they were on a white background, and then someone cut them off and then pasted
that's
them.
That's true.
Yeah, so it's
slightly dodgy.
It's quite weird.
So yeah, it's just kind of disappointing that something that was seen as like the height of one kind of art in one kind of game goes to the absolute. It's not even middle of the road, because middle of the road would be high quality. This is actually exceptional in how sort of bad it looks.
There's no release date, so
you wonder if this will improve dramatically, and then, you know, if that's the case, you wonder why they showed this. Something I heard from somebody, you know, quite, you know, inside fighting games, it's like, you know what they should have done? They should have shown the logo.
Yeah.
The logo design looks great. They should just put that, and then people would just go, Kenneth, 14's coming! Oh, God! And they'd start speculating. There would be hype, I suppose, and they could go, we better make this look good, instead of like, here, meh.
And now they have us talking shit about it, and obviously we are.
Yeah, and we never even played KOF. Yeah. I've played like an hour of it.
Probably never even gonna.
If it looks like this, I won't.
No.
Like, I mean, I'm not usually like superficial on this shit, but fighting games is actually quite important what it looks like.
Which takes us to pony fighting. Pony fighting!
Yeah, so there's not a Kickstarter, but an Indiegogo. I
don't know how they're doing. I didn't check.
They are 48% funded, 20 days to go, $207,000 raised. They want about 430. This is Them's Fighting Herds. And so essentially this is kind of cute animals, but looks like a hardcore 2D style fighter. I believe the character designer did work on Friendship is Magic. So somebody who's got chops, at least, in this kind of design. Obviously, I don't really care. I mean, the artwork. The only problem is obviously the danger of it attracting the wrong crowd. You know, bronies.
It will, but
I mean, the thing is that you'll have the opportunity, if you decide to play this, to beat the fucking shit out of them, which is which is somewhat attractive. The thing about the demo is that it does look legit, like it actually could be the game.
Exactly. I know, you look, there's like massive combos going on in there.
Yeah, and it all looks pretty nice. I mean, if you've got the right people on it, it could end up being something really cool, even though it looks I mean, obviously it's not the aesthetic I choose, but at least with the aesthetic they've chosen, they've done something very successful. So yeah, it could be a thing. It could be a thing.
I wonder if this is the final look, or if this is are these characters done and they need money for the rest, or are these also going to improve, for example? Because like it's similar looking to me to like Skull. Skullgirls. Skullgirls. Yeah.
Yeah, somewhat like that.
Kind of, but the Skullgirls
change not much, but a little.
But animation in Skullgirls is above this, though. There's like,
oh, yeah,
in terms
they
of
have,
its
they put
detail.
In frames.
Yeah.
They actually just animated it at, like, I don't know if it was 60, but they animated very, like, this looks like it's animated the same amount you'd animate a cartoon.
Yeah.
And that's kind of true for a lot of anime fighters, actually. Like, a lot of editions of Guilty Gear, they actually move very slow-looking.
Hmm.
Whereas Skullgirls, one of the things that is striking about it when you look at it early on, is like, they're moving a lot. You're like, whoa! And it may even be that you don't like the particular kind of drawing style of the Skullgirls character, but then often you're just won over by the way that they move and inhabit the world.
Indeed. I watched, how much time did they got left in there, Indiegogo?
Let's have a look. I'm so unfamiliar with Indiegogos. I always suspicious when I see an Indiegogo, because I'm like, you couldn't do a Kickstarter?
What's wrong with you? Hey, I'm walking 20... here.
They're halfway done. Which is in 10 days. They've got 20 days left to get the other half.
But, you know, Indiegogo, you get whatever you get anyway.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Unless they set it, like, the default thing is whatever
people get. No, it's fixed funding, so it's in the Kickstarter style.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I guess they had a beef with the Kickstarter guys, and they were like, couldn't really do anything.
Fuck Kickstarter.
Yeah. This is us done with the fighting games and moving into the general miscellaneous
video game news. Except possibly the article about why compete in the tournament?
Oh, no, that's true. I didn't have the image for that, but that was pretty cool. That was on, was it Games Network?
PC Gamer.
Oh, PC Gamer, okay.
Yep.
You wanna mention it?
I've been talking a lot.
I believe one of the journalists went to participate in the first, which was, I think, a San Francisco tournament of Rising Thunder.
Yeah.
And he mostly got his shit pushed in, but he really enjoyed taking part in the competition. Again, that's like a medium-sized article, if you want to take a look. It's in the description of the video. He's essentially... It's kind of cool. He's comparing it to, like, this anime where, obviously, Japanese teenagers in high school... but they are all, at least all the characters in this, all the heroes, all the characters in this anime are professional ping pong players.
Yeah.
And he's talking about like how they're being introduced.
Yeah.
And like what kind of paddle they have, what's their grip like, and then that kind of stuff. And so he really enjoyed this because he said that he's not one of the people who's very competitive in general or played a lot of competitive games, but he really relished the fact of people being really into it. Like, even though like his play was shitty because he was not very good at the game, people were like looking at him and like analyzing what was going on and taking a lot of attention and care. And he was like this huge amount of interest and the language they've developed, etc., which made it so much enjoyable. So he was essentially encouraging people to do the same thing, and even if they're not very good, take part in tournaments and in competitive events with video games to get the same kind of vibes as a result.
Yeah.
Did I do it? Did I cover it correctly?
You nailed it.
I nailed it.
So one small thing to add is that in the article is a video of the final. Obviously,
I haven't seen it actually.
Gamer writer, it's really good because it's F Champ and it's Chell versus Minato, somebody I don't know, but who's playing Edge, and it's we thought we were doing quite well, and we're not like a million miles off because the execution barrier of Rising Thunder is so low, but there are some moves and points during this, especially towards the end, where you're like, all right, F Champ, fair enough, you are God. there's a moment where Edge does an uppercut to take Chell out of the air. So F Champ fires a projectile in the air, holding him up long enough to avoid the uppercut, and the projectile hits Edge at the end of his uppercut and wins the round.
Wow,
it's really pretty cool. Good. So recommended watching. And it's really nice to see kind of. Tournament outsiders. I mean, we're also tournament outsiders. We've never been to a fighting game tournament. It's something I may eventually.
I'm a life outsider.
but it's nice to see as well the effects that Seth Killian wanted with this game is that it appears that it is slightly more feasible to even get anywhere close to this as an outsider and perhaps grow fighting games a bit and let people play a bit more and it become more legit so that. You know, so that people will be playing something interesting and competitive, like fighting games, instead of something boring and competitive, like League.
what am I doing? One sec. Sorry, clicked the wrong thing. I'm just gonna go to this image before we switch to it. But yeah, I was gonna say that. Look, you're a legendary player now.
Oh yeah.
And this is really your first serious fighting game.
Yeah. I would say. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. So he did it. He achieved this goal. Excellent. Which leads us to this image. So we're in the miscellaneous video game news territory. This is Kojima with a large piece of Spanish, I believe, ham.
What are you talking about? That's Kojima standing next to the latest model of Quiet.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, she has, great-grandmother was Spanish. So...
also didn't speak.
Yeah, just like this piece of ham. So the reason this is on your screen is because it is official now that Konami isn't working on the sequel for Metal Gear Solid. At least nothing that would be on a actual computer.
Yeah.
They will probably do like, what do you call it? The Bejeweled with the MGS theme on your mobile device.
Metal Gear Pachinko.
Yeah. Is that, that must be a thing. Like,
maybe.
Come on, this must be like a slot machine where it's like, quiet, quiet. Oh no, it's your little puppy.
From D-Dog. No.
Yeah. So they are, they're the only console game.
A triple A console game.
Yeah. Well, did they have indie console games?
Well, it's the thing seems to be that they're ceasing AAA console production, so maybe there is some smaller console stuff for handhelds that they still do.
Maybe. They've never really done that. There's no like non-mobile handhelds anymore. The PlayStation Diva, Viva, whatever it's called, is not being like made into a new thing. They're discontinuing that line, for example. So there isn't really... There's just going to be phones. And non-phones. So
yeah, I think that's probably what it will be.
Yeah, the only thing that you've left is, what is it called? Ultimate Soccer Ball?
PES, which is Pro Evolution Soccer,
I guess. There you go. That's the one. That's the only thing. And they also have the Euro rights to the Euro 16 championship, or football championship, so they're probably going to do like shitty game about that. Since they have the rights already, so might as well use them or whatever. And that's why we have this picture of Kojima with Quiet on...
him standing next to Guillermo del Toro, who's represented by the Spanish
man. Guillermo del Toro couldn't be there, and he sent this... his representative. He delegated his power to...
his representative is currently tweeting online about all the cool things that would have been in PT if they'd let him, including all the best horror art, all the best music, all the best everything, but you can't have it now because it's cancelled, it's over. And he'll never stop tweeting about how good it would be.
Exactly. because I'm also like currently reading Neuromancer, it makes sense that this is meat, because he talks about meat a lot, you know? That's meat wanting to do something. Meat travels. Anyway, Xenonauts 2 has meat in it. It's a distinct possibility now. Says
apparently better than half.
Ooh, yeah. It's like it's above 51%.
He chance. Owns a controlling share in the possibility of Xenonauts 2.
So they did pretty well, all things considered, with Xenonauts 1, I believe. And they were actually going to do a different game, which was undisclosed different game, as far as I know. Because when I met him like a few years ago, Chris England, the main guy behind Xenonauts 2, he was like, I can't wait to be done with Xenonauts 1. And but I think he later on Twitter, he said that he was kind of surprised at how well it did in terms of sales. And I think...
Oh, I've lost audio with you.
Have you?
Oh, there you are. He said he kind of, and then cut out.
He kind of, what did they say about him being happy about the sales?
No, I didn't hear that. Sorry for this weird technical snatter in the middle of your podcast.
Right. No problem. So this is, so he said that he was saying how well they did, and he was surprised at how well the games has sold, and probably has sold even better since then because of bundles, sales, blah, blah, blah.
And our Let's Play.
Our Let's Play did actually pretty well for them. And so they're now, instead of thinking about some other game, and I think he was actually, I may misremember it, but I think he mentioned remaking Syndicate at the time. But now he's thinking about their next game being not really confirmed yet, but maybe it will be Xenonauts 2. And he even published these two images you see on your screen. One of them is the season or whatever remade into a more alien looking thing, and then the other one is their 3D engine, because they want to do it in 3D if they're doing it.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. So it's going to be with a 2D aesthetic, but it's actually going to be in 3D because I think they struggle a lot with the 2D stuff.
Yeah.
And they just wanted to simplify the process for themselves. And maybe one of the things they struggled with is they didn't have like randomly generated maps and people less. That was my complaint, to be honest. The maps were like fucking same. And I was using an extra user-made map pack.
Oh.
And I got like, God damn it, it's the same tractor in the same field. Fuck this tractor.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay, that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So it'd be interesting. You know, whenever someone says like, "Oh, well, it's kind of like probably very likely it's probably gonna happen."
Yeah.
So it's which is cool. I'm very I didn't expect it, and it's very happy. I'm very happy that this is actually gonna happen. Probably.
Probably. Allegedly.
Allegedly. So,
we're in Britain. You have to say allegedly, otherwise it's slander, I guess.
Oh, really? Well, probably doesn't.
Yeah, you might be defamating. Defamating.
Deafening.
Defecating. You might be defecating Chris England.
Oh, the Chris England. I'm so sorry I let you through my bowels. wait, is allegedly and probably not the same thing?
No, allegedly is like the specific legal sort of get out of jail free for libel. So this actually ended up being a thing where one of the guys from the show Have I Got News For You, are you aware of it? That show?
Yes. Yeah.
One of the guys was being sued by somebody who he basically accused of something that I think he did or whatever. But I think the other guy won the case or something like that. But anyway, one really long-running joke in the show was that he would say the thing that the guy did, and then there'd be a pause, and then he'd say, allegedly.
Excellent.
So, yeah.
Be funny if I'm in court, like, for saying that this one of us is happening.
But then I look forward to your statement where you make the pause and then go,
allegedly.
And then you look around and everyone's like, hmm.
But then he actually makes the Syndicate remake, like he told me 3 years ago. next thing is actually something I saw, like, half an hour before we had started the show, so I'm not sure you saw it in there.
Humble?
Yeah, so Humble has a new thing called Humble Monthly.
People don't like it.
Yeah, a lot of people don't like it, apparently. I'm interested to see what they actually deliver in that. But it's a subscription service. This is not canceling anything that Humble is doing already. It's just an addition to what they're doing. Where you subscribe for this for $12 a month. Yeah. And as a result, you get games. But
so whatever bundle they pick for that month.
For specifically this. So
maybe
it's not
themed or whatever.
Yeah, so it's not going to correspond to or coincide with or overlap with anything else. And they also said games that haven't been in other bundles are going to be in this bundle. So it's interesting. I'm even thinking about subscribing just to see. Actually, I can probably see what is in there, like, anyway, and whatever. But
is it something where you can wait for the bundle to drop and then decide if you want
to
get it?
No, you have to have it as before it drops. So you subscribe beforehand, then it drops, and you get it. I think because that's the whole thing of you not knowing what's going to be in there. It's kind of like the
Loot Crate.
Yes, exactly. That's the name I was trying to remember. So kind of like Loot Crate, but with games. But yeah, I mean, knowing what Humble Bundle stands for, it probably will be much like value. Because, you know, when you can get usually pay $1, you can get, like, something that would, by default, cost maybe, I don't know, $30 or something. So, so if this is 12, then divide, you know, 30 multiplied by 12, that's like, so I'm expecting about 400.
That's like 300.
Yeah, $400 is please. That would be nice.
And other mathematical equations that don't really relate to what we're talking about. So.
Exactly.
But yeah, I mean, usually it's like, have you seen the bundle for this month? Like, unfortunately, I own everything in it, but they're all great. Like, Xenonauts is in there, Gang Beasts is in there, there's some other really good one was in there.
Sorry Being Hunted is in there.
Yeah, Sorry Being Hunted is in there.
There was also Total Annihilation was in there, which cost like £30.
Yeah. So just in this particular one, I was like, it was remarkable just for the fact that it happened to be a bunch of stuff I liked.
Mm.
Obviously, it's not related to the Humble Monthly because that will be its own thing. I think I might wait and watch and see what they have in the first couple. I can understand why people might be like, well, this is bullshit, but you don't have to sign up for it if you don't want to.
Maybe that's what they feel. They feel like, oh, God, it's happening now. I have to sign up, but I hate it.
You're all fucking idiots. Yeah, I don't know. I can kind of understand why someone wouldn't sign up for it, but I can't understand why someone would hate it, if you get me.
Yeah. I think the first one is probably going to be the best one, so that's why I'm thinking about signing up for it.
Yeah, I bet that will have some fucking crazy shit.
Yeah, and then the second one is going to be like the difficult second album, as always. Which leads us to this question. Ed, would you have sex with a robot?
That's an interesting question, Andro. Yeah. I will return America to the American dream. We can do this if we try hard. Has that answered your question? Thank you. Next question.
You're already participating in a presidential debate, I see.
One thing I will say is that I wouldn't ban anyone from fucking a robot.
What if the robot doesn't like it?
Then they're not a robot.
Ah, I see. So there's people who are campaigning currently. I've tried to find out who exactly they are. I found like one professor dude's name, but
it'd be great if you find out that they're actually robots.
Because if you go on their website and click like about, it just says what they're about. They don't say who they are. Yeah, it just goes beep boop. So, in case you were kind of falling behind the recent advancements in the sexual gratification technology, apparently you can already buy like sex bots. So it's essentially, as I understand, it's kind of a talking, moaning, inflatable stuff that you can purchase. And more is being developed, but there are people who are against this. But they're against this for interesting reasons, in my opinion.
Okay.
So at first I thought like, oh, robot ethics or whatever, like it's unfair towards the robots. Now they're saying it's unfair towards the people because, in their opinion, having sex with robots leads people to think that people are like robots, and then they would be abusing people as a result. Which is a bit of a...
This is a video game argument, but with sex.
Yes, it is a video game argument, but with sex. It's a bit of a stretch. A little bit, I think. So
I would hope for $7,000 it would be.
But what they're also saying is... by the way, I love this image with the robot carrying a woman.
It's so good.
Yeah. They're also saying... I'm going to actually freeze it on that one sec. Just going to do... In show, which one is that? Is that the one? Oh, this. Okay. Yeah, there you go. So it's going to just stay on this one. the way the way they talk is also like, I'm thinking like, are you actually artificial intelligence? Because they're saying this is bad for women, children, and men. I'm not, this is a quote. Yeah. So this is a quote from their about page. Like, this is detrimental to women, children, and men. So, which is like, so people, you're saying, you're saying it's bad for people, isn't it?
Each person equals bad for return. Oh no.
So yeah, the argument is that essentially like objectification. So this serves the this promotes objectification of sex further. Yeah. So like, oh well, I'm fucking this thing, and when I'm having sex with a person, oh, I'm fucking this thing. Which is, I kind of get it where it comes from, but it's a bit of a simplification in general.
Yeah, it's too... Yeah, it's just a weird oversimplification. Because
that's like saying, like, oh, if you masturbate, that's then you have sex with a person. It's like you thinking that that person is
a
hand.
You think everyone's a hand.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, it's, you know...
It's stupid. It's stupid alarm as shit. You can apply it to any new thing ever. There'll be this person for it. It just happens to be on something hilarious this time.
Yeah, exactly. But they're campaigning around the world. They're did a thing in Sweden and in somewhere else, and they're like gathering crowds or whatever. That's the website
that's,
says.
That's difficult to gather a crowd in Sweden.
Yeah, I mean, crowd are like probably seven people is a crowd according to their definition. So.
That's a mosh pit.
I call this a crowd. I pronounce you crowd and crowd.
My favorite part of this article is sort of somewhat tangential, but near the bottom it talks about the author of the book Love and Sex with Robots. And the author's name is David Levy. And the only reason this is funny is that the CTO of the company I work at is called David Levy. And Yeah, he's a pretty cool guy, and I find it. But I think this is the second thing I've seen by an author, David Levy, which is just like embarrassing. Like I keep finding things with his name attached to it that's not him. That's horribly embarrassing, and I keep wanting to tell him, but he's quite important in the company. And I think he would just be like, "Shut up, Ed," so I don't bother.
Your Penis Is Your Friend by David Levy.
Just buy the book and give it to him. Yeah. There you go.
Happy birthday! Which leads us to spider robots.
Of course.
Spider robot. This is a sped up footage, by the way. Spider robots making.
There's a spider human as well.
There's a spider human at the end. Make a bridge. Yeah. And so, in case you need a bridge.
It's the first useful demonstration of robotics I've seen for years.
What about all this photography that the bots do, you know, the videos that they shoot from above?
Well, like that time that they hassled that guy on the wind farm.
Yeah. All the seagulls they scare. All that stuff. They're pretty decent. So yeah, though this I think it's an MIT thing, obviously controlled environment very much. So
yeah.
The robot stuff happening is increased 4 times in speed, and then the guy walking on the bridge is 20 times. So that guy is actually not that fast. Don't worry, it's not gonna jump.
Why did he need to be sped up 20 times and then 4 times? Was he embarrassed?
I think he was like he was very
how
slow.
How irrelevant he was.
Yeah, he probably cried. He stopped in the middle and cried because he was afraid of the height of like 1 meter. And he was like pretty embarrassed about this, and he was like, Jeff, can you please like speed up like 20 times?
Or isn't it like there's a limit on the length of a vine, and they're like, oh yeah, we had to speed you up 20 times to fit you at the end of it because your robots are too slow? And he's like, not only have you embarrassed me, you've embarrassed my robots.
The robots blush.
Yeah.
Black.
But it's very cool. What I like about this demonstration of technology is like, oh, you could use this in somewhere which is hard to access, like some random village in India. They need a rope bridge, boom. Fly some drones there for a day, and they've actually built one. This is actually useful application for drones, finally.
And then the villagers grab the drones, and they sell them on the black market, and they have bread
absolutely.
For 3 days.
So, like, you don't even have to dispose of the drones once they're done. Remember, they'll be, like, made by Apple, so they'll be out of date 2 months in, you know, so there you go.
How about, like, drones where, say, Amazon drones... And they come, they bring you the package to your doorstep, but they realize you don't have a door. And then they build you a door. And then they knock on the door that they just built. And then you're like, oh my god, I have a door now. You open it, and they're like, thank you, Amazon.
I'm looking forward to the article where it says, this enterprising homeless man tricks Amazon drones into building him a house.
Made of doors.
Made of doors. Yeah. It's all fine until he falls down the stairwell and he realizes it was an Escher house. He never stops. So yeah, that looks cool. Robot overlords, it's coming, etc.
I'm a bit worried now because there was like a phone ringing sound and it stopped. I think the robots know that we're joking about them. We should. Robots are good.
Robots are good. I would have sex with a robot.
Yeah. Or yeah, many, maybe.
Or two.
SSD, let's move on to Formula Robots. new technology in data storage is happening, and it's using, obviously, light, because after we conquered the solid-state drives, next one is the light, flash a light in the eye laser storage technology. So the problem with this is that so far, until recently... they had problems with making it non-volatile. Non-volatile meaning that you turn off the electricity and it stays, the data stays there, and then you couldn't do it. But now apparently they can do it. They figured out how to do it using, I guess, getting inspiration from DVDs.
Yeah.
So they're using lasers to sort of write stuff in crystals, to put it simply. And then they turn off the laser and the crystals stay there.
So it kind just reminds me of Mike Sacco's current Twitter thing, which is, give me his dead son's crystal. It's his favorite like dialogue line from a video game, and he keeps saying it. Please continue.
I also live and die by the crystals. So I think what this allows is, like, what was it, 100 times faster data retrieval, I think, was it? Eventually. And then if also this is connected to like a CPU that works also with the light as opposed to the traditional CPU's structure.
Yeah, I think it would be like if MS you balls. Had your CPU structure based on light and your memory access based on light and storage, I guess, you could end up with machines that are up 200 times faster than, I guess, the limit of the ones we have now, which sounds great.
So we,
I'm looking forward to a rock-solid 60 in a town in armor.
So we already have, like, except for me, everyone has, like, the light-based internet, which is fiber. Then there's the Li-Fi, which the fiber gets to your router, and then you use Li-Fi to get with lasers to your computer. Then you'd have a light CPU and then light storage. We just need light RAM, I think.
Yeah.
Laser.
And then, and then a way of getting light as a signal into your eye. Oh, wait, we already have that.
Oh, yeah, it's called the eyes. So anyway, yeah, this could be cool. This could be pretty cool. It's probably still a few years away, but they're like quite confident in what they're doing. They're like, we already have the technology to sell this commercially, which is a pretty big thing to say. So hopefully they're not going to...
Good. I want it to push the price of everything else down, come out good, and then become cheap.
Yep.
This is like the only time, consumer electronics seems to be the only instance where capitalism works.
It did, yeah, exactly. Yeah. In terms of like how price goes, it does go kind of slowly sometimes. Like you still can't really buy a 4K monitor or really use it. But
yeah. But that's more than just price though. That's like people need to make things in 4K.
Yeah, there's tons of videos in 4K on YouTube, but no one can really enjoy them really, because even if you have a 4K monitor, then you need like 10,000 GPUs to even make it light up.
Yeah.
Etc. Which brings us
capture, 4K editing.
Sorry. Yeah, exactly.
Too.
The what the fuck section of the show. Yeah, my favorite section. And we start with actually continue with the computers. This is the most Scottish PC that you've ever seen. This gentleman in Glasgow who has a computer shop made a computer that is seemingly being cooled by irn-bru. Disclaimer, is not actually being cooled by irn-bru. That would be horrible for your computer because it has sugar in it and they would probably crystallize and then there would be like electric current going through the irn-bru and then you...
So what is he actually using?
Some orange colored thing that goes into a bottle from irn-bru. So he's using
orange colored coolant, that's all it is.
Yeah, but then he added all those like orange lights and then put little orange bottles or irn-bru bottles on top and then the actual bottle does contain the actual fluid. He just adapted it to the thing.
Okay.
And it's actually sitting on the tartan as well, so like it's extremely like the table is covered with the with some clan's thing, so it's all very Scottish.
Yeah, that's lovely. This is the thing, like case mods. The problem with case mods is the problem with creator characters where you then actually take your creator character and interact with other people is because they always make it like black and red and they look cool. You want people with creator character systems to make something that actually does represent them or is unique in some way. And so this guy's done it. Whenever we go to trade shows, like we saw this at EGX, we saw it at Insomnia, there's always that scan.co.uk like booth where they have these machines and they're powered by robot cum or whatever. And you're just, you know, all these tubes with fluid.
Favorite cum.
Yeah, exactly. And the ridiculous components inside. You're like, that's cool. I won't buy that. That's £4,000. It probably isn't really as good as the thing I've got at home anyway. But I like when people do case mods and projects that are makery. They make something like this. That's cool. Well done.
Well done.
It's called the iMac. Like the I. Yes, Mac. That's great. That's cool.
Excellent. Our next item in the What the Fuck news is the guy who was actually like involved in a chase with the police. He was going 100 miles an hour some road somewhere and then crashed into several vehicles and finally surrendered. This is not happening in America, by the way. I think it was around here. I forget where he was from a town that is like...
Gegness.
Yeah, there you go. I don't even know where that is, to be honest.
That's Midlands on the east coast.
People are friendlier there. but my favorite bit... So essentially he said, he told them he had no license and he had no insurance on his car.
Yeah.
And it was not his car. It was someone else's car. And he explained to them that he had learned how to drive a car on a PlayStation.
Yeah.
So hence this thing ended up in our show. But my favorite bit is what the judge told him as part of the verdict when he delivered it. And this is amazing. This is like, he is the generic dad who has heard about video games. He said, "You said you only learned to drive on a PlayStation game," the judge told Jones. "You were driving like a PlayStation game, full stop. You drove as fast as you could, as if in a video or PlayStation game, without any care for those around you, full stop."
Now, there's one thing I'd like to add to that, and that it really affects what I think of this guy, whether he should be allowed on the road, and the verdict of this judge, and it's, which PlayStation game did he learn to drive on? Because if he learned to drive on Gran Turismo, and we find he has a little flash memory card save file, and he's passed the A ranking driver's license, give him back the fucking key to that car, because it was all those fucking cars' fault that they got damaged in his path. I'm surprised he was only going 100 miles per hour. You know how difficult it is to get the fucking licenses on Gran Turismo? Like, if it is that, you know, hats off. If it's like Burnout, then you're like, oh, I'm just glad no one died.
I think that he's probably was like Forza. I think he was a bit younger. I don't think he probably... Is this Gran Turismo still around?
I don't know. I don't think I've heard of a new one for a few years now.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know.
I think Forza, whatever, is all the rage, and it looks a bit like ass. Which leads us to the gift card conundrum. Now, this is very strange, and some guy was like trying to educate me on Twitter about this as well. I didn't even reply because I was bored at this point already with the problem. So, Star Citizen. So I was actually first going to put this in the Star Citizen section, like a separate section, which we
it's always sometimes. The same thing. There's always something.
Yeah, but this is like so much what the fuck that I decided to put in the what the fuck section. So they're selling gift cards now.
Yeah.
And for example, if you wanted to buy a $50 gift card for Star Citizen, you would have to pay $60 for it.
Yeah, in order to pay the VAT in this country.
Yeah, or whatever country you're in. I'm not sure where the people who made like published this article accessed it from. I'm guessing UK, because the magazine,
they keep talking about the UK.
The magazine is based in UK. But they don't even show you the price in the pounds, for one thing, which is insulting. And second one is that this is not how you do this shit. There's a lot of people, obviously a lot of fans, who came to the rescue and started defending this, and they're like, oh no, it's fine, this is the way it's meant to be. For example, in UK, if you're to buy a Amazon gift card to, you know, whatever, give it to someone, you pay the price, which is whatever the price says. It's a £20 gift card, you buy a £20 gift card. Then when someone spends a £20 gift card, they obviously pay the VAT on the item they buy. In this case, they're explaining, oh, it's fine. You prepay the VAT. And when you're buying something in the store, in the in-game, whatever thing they probably have, then we give you the discount on the VAT. You don't pay it there. Which
I have a question at this point. Is there VAT on items in stores that are digital?
I don't know, is there?
And are the VAT rules for that versus a gift card different? Because a gift card is like a physical thing with like stored value. Maybe it's a different type of thing, whereas like a DLC add-on, whatever, for a video game may be categorized differently to a gift card. Because the one question I have about all of this, really, is could someone go, there's a ship in Star Citizen, it's $50, so they buy it for $50. Or there's a friend who says, I'm going to get you a gift card so you can get that ship in Star Citizen, and has to pay $60.
I think what they're saying is that it would have been $60 if you had purchased it directly with money instead of gift card, with your card, like credit card. But now that you're buying with the gift card, then you'll pay $60 for it, get a $50 card, and then get a $50 that's good enough for
$50 shit.
So you're still paying the
but
same.
But it's the same thing.
So you were
the same thing out the end.
Yeah, yeah. So you're paying the same amount of money at the end, but they have to seem to have done this like other way around, because this is like, I not that I'm like into marketing or I love it or whatever, but it's like,
yeah.
Can you just not see how people will be like fuck
that?
Oh yeah.
So you could have just solved this by putting the
other way around.
Yeah, putting the VAT on the DLC thing item,
and that's it.
And that's it.
Yeah.
So their claim is that you have to put the VAT price as displayed on your gift card, and that's why they had to display and have value separately. But then, how does the Amazon gift card thing work if that's the case?
Exactly. Yeah. It seems like
a little confusing.
Yeah, because even the Steam cards are the same. So if I were to buy today, go and now buy like a £50 wallet card, like whatever Steam wallet. £50 and get like, I want to give it to you, right? So I pay £50 and I get a £50 wallet money, and then I'd be like, okay, send it to Ed Hicks, and Ed Hicks gets it and it's £50. And when you buy a game, then obviously you pay VAT for that game, but it's also already part of the price. So it's all like, what the hell are you doing? Why are you doing this to yourself? But then there are people who are saying that this is actually how it works in some European countries, apparently, where if they go to a shop and they buy a gift card, I don't know, somewhere, maybe in Germany somewhere, and they actually like pay more for the value, whatever. I don't know. It's so crooked. That's why you can't see. See, we're still figuring out. We started talking about this like 7 minutes ago, and we're starting to figure out what the fuck's going on.
Yeah, this is the thing. I can't really get angry about it because I'm confused. I'm too confused.
Yeah. No, this is here purely because it's confusing.
I think someone fucked up. But I don't know.
Yeah, I have this feeling that someone fucked up. Oh, sorry.
Claudia says Germany's not like that.
Yeah.
So.
And wait, when was the last time you were in Germany, Claudia? Come on. Things have changed since then. Ask that one guy that you met and registered for his gaming group. He will know. He actually
lives actually, I won't put it on the podcast, but I've got something to say about that afterwards. I'll tell you about. It's kind of amusing development on that regard. Anyway.
Excellent. So we have the last thing left, and this is my favorite thing that happened like this month, probably. So, guy whose name is John Hendren, known as Fart on Twitter.
On Weird Twitter.
On Weird Twitter. Was invited to a US pretty big, apparently, cable channel, HLN. Yeah. I've never heard about them before, but I checked them up, and they have a lot of followers on Twitter, so I guess they have some amount of viewers. He was invited as someone who defends or likes Edward Snowden.
Yeah.
And this is following the fact that Edward Snowden now has a Twitter account, and the first person or whatever entity he followed was an NSA, etc. Yeah. So this thing is happening. And while he was talking about this, or that she was asking, like, what about, you know, people thinking he's a traitor, blah blah. He stopped like talking about, or maybe he started to specify that he was actually talking about Edward Scissorhands, and he answered three questions total, talking about Edward Scissorhands. I liked it. This is like my kind of, absolutely my kind of, 100% my kind of joke. So I'm actually gonna quote this guy. This was genius. So when she asked him, he said some people. Oh, so he started with like some people think he's not a hero, and he said that they are wrong, and he's doing the most patriotic thing possible. And then she asked, "Could he have hurt someone?" And then he replied, "Absolutely, he could. But I think to cast him out, to make him invalid in society, simply because he has scissors for hands. I mean, that's strange. People didn't get scared until he started sculpting shrubs into dinosaur shapes and whatnot," he said on the national TV.
she just charges on. She just goes to the next item and says nothing had happened.
And she's like, "What about him being like hiding in Russia?" And she's like, "Casting him out is just completely wrong. We're treating him like an animal, like someone who should be quarantined and put away just because he was created on top of a mountain by Vincent Price, incomplete, with scissors for hand and no heart. Edward Scissorhands is complete hero to me."
No, the thing is that they were looking for another John Hendren. I can't remember exactly what his credentials were, but it was somewhat appropriate that other guy...
I actually...
Yeah, yeah. What happened was they got in touch with this dude with a handle Fart, because his name is John Hendren.
Yeah.
But they just looked for John Hendren on Twitter, found this guy, and then just invited him, and he was like, okay. This is like, as far as I know, this is a fuck up on their end that he just went along with and prepared for, and it's perfect because they punch themselves in the face. And he just calmly, this is like that time the BBC accidentally got that cabbie in to talk about some shit, and he was just like, oh fuck, and he just went along with it until the interview was over. But with this one, it's actually like a professional comedian. Just this material falls in his lap, and he's like, okay, and he plays it straight. He plays it perfectly. It's beautiful. Watch the video. It's so funny.
There's not a single. He's like completely deadpan. Not a single smile. The last thing he says is like, we cussed him out. He says again, we get scared when he poked a hole in a waterbed with his scissor fingers, and that was unreasonable of us. And they're like, oh, thank you, John, for being here. It's like, no, thank you.
This is the fucking bleeding edge of comedy. It's shit like this.
Yeah, this is amazing.
It's fucking amazing.
Oh, so good. And then they have they also show him the clip where, like,
he's talking to
Oliver. What's his name? Yeah, yeah. John Oliver?
That was his name.
And then he says like something like, "You fucked him" or something, and he's like, "Yeah, I fucked him." But then when he says "fuck," like they blur. You know when in America?
Oh yeah, they just blur out.
They blur the. Yeah, they blur the mouth out. Is that because of like deaf people who may read lips?
Or deaf children. Yeah, that's why they take the word "fuck" out. Can't tell them about that. I don't know. I think it's slightly overzealous censorship, which is funny considering they're doing a segment on whether or not Edward Snowden is good.
Edward Scissorhands, please. It's not Edward Snowden.
Edward Scissorhands, nothing. Sorry.
Because then he tweeted this Jonas. He tweeted like, no, I sincerely thought we were talking about Edward Scissorhands.
To follow this guy, I can't believe I'm not currently following
him. So good. It's amazing. He also like lists himself as a Silicon Valley genius or something like that, leader of the industry.
Oh my god. Very proud to be one notch above cop car with bees on it, thanks to all. Perfect. Oh, what a way to end a feature length show.
Approximately
2.25 hours.
Double feature, triple feature length. This is like 3 movies in one. It's an omnibus.
Even Claudia showed up, and she hates hearing our voices.
We were here so long that even Claudia showed up.
All the other shows finished.
Yeah, there's nothing else to watch in the world.
Oh man.
Anything else you want to say before we part?
Next week will be shorter.
It's true. He's not lying. That is legit.
Don't make the news, kids.
Yeah, we'll have to talk about you. And you don't want that. Yeah. We take no prisoners. No. Yeah.
We fuck only, robots for life.
We fuck robots for jobs. This is this is our life.
Imagine being a robot sex bot QA.
I bet that it must be a thing, right?
Yeah, of course. You have to. First, you have to test it on animals, though.
What about the Autoblow 3000 QA?
I think it was just that one guy.
What, the one that wrote the Vice article? Apparently that thing is horrible.
Yeah, apparently it's like grinding sounds.
It really hurts.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like really bad.
I think
like,
that guy just wanted people to think he had a really big dick.
I think he showed you a picture of his dick and he wasn't that big.
Okay.
Maybe. Because he was like...
exhibit, everybody.
He was like, you have to use like a half a bottle of lube to even like make it work.
What, just as filler? Or you mean just to stop it from like tearing you?
Just tearing you apart, yeah.
Jesus.
Which is a good point to end the show on. Thank you very much for watching. If you're watching this on YouTube, please hit the dislike button because we fucking hate this. And if you're watching on Twitch, thanks for hanging out. And we'll see you in the next one, which is going to be next Thursday this time around. Not going to be a 3-week break. It's going to be just next Thursday, 10. Is it still BST?
Oh, it's a good question.
Is it? It's until the 30th of October.
I think it's like third week.
Halloween is when it switches, because that's when the spirits decided the time zone.
Decided to go to bed earlier.
Yeah, exactly.
Or later.
Later, that's good. It's we'll see you later. Bye. Done did it. Goof up.
Claudia, I was bored.